Penguin Random House Audio presents Exhalation by Ted Chiang. Read for you by Edoardo Ballerini, Dominic Hoffman, Amy Landon, and Ted Chiang.
The Merchant and the Alchemist's Gate. O mighty Caliph and Commander of the Faithful, I am humbled to be in the splendor of your presence. A man can hope for no greater blessing as long as he lives. The story I have to tell is truly a strange one, and were the entirety to be tattooed at the corner of one's eye, the marvel of its presentation would not exceed that of the events recounted, for it is a warning to those who would be warned and a lesson to those who would learn. My name is Fuad ibn Abbas, and I was born here in Baghdad, City of Peace. My father was a grain merchant, but for much of my life, I have worked as a purveyor of fine fabrics, trading in silk from Damascus and linen from Egypt and scarves from Morocco that are embroidered with gold. I was prosperous, but my heart was troubled, and neither the purchase of luxuries nor the giving of alms was able to soothe it. Now I stand before you, without a single dirham in my purse, but I am at peace. Allah is the beginning of all things, but with your majesty's permission, I begin my story with the day I took a walk through the district of metalsmiths. I needed to purchase a gift for a man I had to do business with, and had been told he might appreciate a tray made of silver. After browsing for half an hour, I noticed that one of the largest shops in the market had been taken over by a new merchant. It was a prized location that must have been expensive to acquire, so I entered to peruse its wares. Never before had I seen such a marvelous assortment of goods. Near the entrance, there was an astrolabe equipped with 7 plates inlaid with silver, a water clock that chimed on the hour, and a nightingale made of brass that sang when the wind blew. Farther inside, there were even more ingenious mechanisms, and I stared at them the way a child watches a juggler, when an old man stepped out from a doorway in the back.
"Welcome to my humble shop, my lord," he said. "My name is Basharat. How may I assist you?"
"These are remarkable items that you have for sale. I deal with traders from every corner of the world, and yet I have never seen their like. From where, may I ask, did you acquire your merchandise?"
"I am grateful to you for your kind words," he said. "Everything you see here was made in my workshop, by myself or by my assistants under my direction."
I was impressed that this man could be so well versed in so many arts. I asked him about the various instruments in his shop, and listened to him discourse learnedly about astrology, mathematics, geomancy, and medicine. We spoke for more than an hour, and my fascination and respect bloomed like a flower warmed by the dawn, until he mentioned his experiments in alchemy.
"Alchemy?" I said.
This surprised me, for he did not seem the sort to make such a sharper's claim.
"You mean you can turn base metal into gold?" "I can, my lord. But that is not, in fact, what most seek from alchemy."
"What do most seek, then?"
"They seek a source of gold that is cheaper than mining ore from the ground. Alchemy does describe a means to make gold, but the procedure is so arduous that, by comparison, digging beneath a mountain is as easy as plucking peaches from a tree."
I smiled. "A clever reply. No one could dispute that you are a learned man. But I know better than to credit alchemy." Basharat looked at me and considered.
"I have recently built something that may change your opinion. You would be the first person I've shown it to. Would you care to see it?"
"It would be a great pleasure.
Please, follow me."
He led me through the doorway in the rear of his shop. The next room was a workshop, arrayed with devices whose functions I could not guess. Bars of metal wrapped with enough copper thread to reach the horizon, mirrors mounted on a circular slab of granite floating in quicksilver. But Basharat walked past these without a glance. Instead, he led me to a sturdy pedestal, chest high, on which a stout metal hoop was mounted upright. The hoop's opening was as wide as 2 outstretched hands, and its rim so thick that it would tax the strongest man to carry. The metal was black as night, but polished to such smoothness that, had it been a different color, it could have served as a mirror. Basharat bade me stand so that I looked upon the hoop edgewise while he stood next to its opening.
"Please observe," he said.
Basharat thrust his arm through the hoop from the right side,
but it did not extend out from the left. Instead, it was as if his arm were severed at the elbow, and he waved the stump up and down and then pulled his arm out intact. I had not expected to see such a learned man perform a conjurer's trick, but it was well done, and I applauded politely.
"Now, wait a moment," he said as he took a step back.
I waited, and behold, an arm reached out of the hoop from its left side, without a body to hold it up. The sleeve it wore matched Basharat's robe. The arm waved up and down, and then retreated through the hoop until it was gone. The first trick I'd thought a clever mime, but this one seemed far superior, because the pedestal and hoop were clearly too slender to conceal a person.
"Very clever," I exclaimed. "Thank you, but this is not mere sleight of hand. The right side of the hoop precedes the left by several seconds. To pass through the hoop is to cross that duration instantly."
"I do not understand," I said.
"Let me repeat the demonstration."
Again he thrust his arm through the hoop, and his arm disappeared. He smiled and pulled back and forth as if playing tug-a-rope. Then he pulled his arm out again and presented his hand to me with the palm open. On it lay a ring I recognized. "That is my ring!" I checked my hand and saw that my ring still lay on my finger. "You have conjured up a duplicate."
"No, this is truly your ring. Wait."
Again an arm reached out from the left side. Wishing to discover the mechanism of the trick, I rushed over to grab it by the hand. It was not a false hand, but one fully warm and alive as mine. I pulled on it, and it pulled back. Then, as deft as a pickpocket, the hand slipped the ring from my finger, and the arm withdrew into the hoop, vanishing completely. "My ring is gone," I exclaimed.
"No, my lord," he said. "Your ring is here."
And he gave me the ring he held.
"Forgive me for my game."
I replaced it on my finger. "You had the ring before it was taken from me." At that moment, an arm reached out, this time from the right side of the hoop.
"What is this?" I exclaimed.
Again, I recognized it as his by the sleeve before it withdrew, but I had not seen him reach in.
"Recall," he said, "the right side of the hoop precedes the left."
And he walked over to the left side of the hoop and thrust his arm through from that side, and again it disappeared. Your Majesty has undoubtedly already grasped this, but it was only then that I understood. Whatever happened on the right side of the hoop was complemented, a few seconds later, by an event on the left side.
"Is this sorcery?" I asked.
"No, my lord. I have never met a genie, and if I did, I would not trust it to do my bidding. This is a form of alchemy."
He offered an explanation, speaking of his search for tiny pores in the skin of reality, like the holes that worms bore into wood, and how upon finding one, he was able to expand and stretch it, the way a glassblower turns a dollop of molten glass into a long-necked pipe, and how he then allowed time to flow like water at one mouth while causing it to thicken like syrup at the other. I confess I did not really understand his words and cannot testify to their truth. All I could say in response was,
"You have created something truly astonishing."
"Thank you," he said. "But this is merely a prelude to what I intended to show you."
He bade me follow him into another room, farther in the back. There stood a circular doorway, whose massive frame was made of the same polished black metal, mounted in the middle of the room.
"What I showed you before was a gate of seconds," he said. "This is a gate of years. The two sides of the doorway are separated by a span of 20 years.
I confess I did not understand his remark immediately. I imagined him reaching his arm in from the right side and waiting 20 years before it emerged from the left side, and it seemed a very obscure magic trick. I said as much, and he laughed.
"That is one use for it," he said. "But consider what would happen if you were to step through."
Standing on the right side, he gestured for me to come closer, and then pointed through the doorway.
"Look."
I looked, and saw that there appeared to be different rugs and pillows on the other side of the room than I had seen when I had entered. I moved my head from side to side and realized that when I peered through the doorway, I was looking at a different room from the one I stood in.
"You are seeing the room 20 years from now," said Basharat.
I blinked, as one might at an illusion of water in the desert, but what I saw did not change. "And you say I could step through?"
I asked.
You could, and with that step, you would visit the Baghdad of 20 years hence. You could seek out your older self and have a conversation with him. Afterward, you could step back through the gate of years and return to the present day.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.